and very few of you know who Kamiru was. He succumbed in the year 2007, and in one of our last conversations, he told me, "Kung'o, I'm going, and I want you to look after my young family. Anytime they need you to start with them, please be there." And I promise to do that, and that's why I'm studying here today. So, same reason, when Bob Kellymore came calling, looking for a boy's heart in marriage, it's me he encountered. He didn't have a choice. And as you've heard, Kolimo was an articulate man in plan and execution. And this occasion was no exception. He put up a team which he thought were the best negotiators in town. And he was not mistaken. That team was led by none other, by the then Attorney General, Professor Githu Muigai. A professor and an attorney general, no less. And they came to our home. Of course, Githu Muigai, because of the connotations of our name, Kung'o Muigai, Githu Muigai, tried to intimidate me to call him father. I agreed, but that didn't help him. He tried to pull rank as the attorney general. That didn't wash. And they realize they have come up against a seasoned dowry bargainer. And of course, I was quick to remind him about his son's seven-figure salary. And things didn't help because his deputy was Joshua Oigara, the CEO of KCB. And I told him I believe he could open the KCB votes on a Saturday afternoon. So we had a nice afternoon. Bob, of course, was very worried. He had no idea what was going on. But the beauty about it is he kept on telling Professor, whatever they want, just do it. Fortunately, I could understand. But eventually, with us, that is just the banter. Otherwise, we have the limits, we have what's laid down. You can't ask for more than what's allowed. But of course, you gain by putting penalties and and fines, real and imagined. And with us, who come from the coffee-growing areas, when the coffee ripens, it's time to pick the coffee, and that was my time to pick the coffee. Eventually, when I told Bob Kolimo I have consented, and I gave him a boy's heart in marriage, the man lit up like a Christmas tree. You know that toothy smile of his? He smiled for a whole straight hour. He was over the moon. And I must say, between me and Mama Wambui, from that day, we have never regretted giving our beautiful daughter to Bob. He looked after her, he adored her, he loved her, he protected her. We were so happy. And that love overflowed to the rest of the family. And Bob was a great, great family man. Some of you will describe Bob in his corporate role, the captain of the captains. But once Bob drove into his compound, you would not recognize him. He becomes this playful, jocular, happy man, joking with his wife. He would go on his force to give the children a giddy up. And those corporate fellows, if you found your Bob in his house, you wouldn't recognize him. We have always been grateful for him. And as we traveled this journey with Wambui, we really felt for her. So today we remember him. He's a great man. And his character, he'll pass it on for generations. And that's what he meant when he said, we are all going to die. What will be remembered is what you do, not that you died. So, Abui, my girl, you've been widowed young, and I'm sure you're going to seek answers to that. Seek them in the Lord. Don't seek them elsewhere. God says he's the husband of the widows, and he comes to visit them. Every time he visits you, ask him your questions. In the fullness of time, he will give you answers. And now before I finish, I want to read a very, very short tribute from Bob's mother-in-law, Professor Wamai. And she says, as a scientist immersed in research and academia, and before Abou introduced Bob Colimo to me, I had never met Bob besides seeing him in the media. Likewise, I cared very little about the better option, as I depended on different telecom companies that served me well. Wabui respectfully introduced Bob to me at our home during their early days of dating. Nice meeting you, Bob Colimo. I hope you are serious about your relationship with my daughter. If you are not, and you are just wasting her time, I'll deal with you single-heartedly with my fair little hands. But in little respect, this was very harsh, but Bob just looked at me and smiled. Throughout his loving and wonderful relationship with Wambui, Bob never gave me any single reason to use my fair hands, and it is now my turn to smile back at Bob. I say to Bob's mother and sister, thank you for giving Bob to my family, to Kenya, and to the world. Bob and I shared a very special mother-son-in-law relationship, and I will highlight just one example among many. During one lunch date, he surprised me by hinting that he was frustrated with having to pop many pills for a long time to tame the leukemia. That lunch conversation was the beginning of our death can wait inspirational phrase. Bob's death waited since November 2017. Of course, death will eventually and surely take us, but we all can celebrate the life of Bob Colimo by using our will to defy death, even as we surprise the doctors, just like Bob Colimo did. As your death awaits, will you be making the world a better or a worse place? Will you be building or destroying the world? Let us all learn from Bob Colimo and use our death waiting time to make this world a better and happier place. Rest in peace, my dear son, Bob. And to Bob, we say fare thee well, travel well. May God give you peace. He gave you to us, and he has seen it fit to take you unto himself. May his great name be praised, and the congregation will say, Amen. Thank you.
Your Excellency, the President of the Republic of Kenya, Your Excellency, the First Lady, Your Excellency, Dr. William Ruto, Excellencies, friends, I've been asked to speak this morning on behalf of the business community. But Bob was more than a business leader. He was a friend. Once in a lifetime cometh a man who against all expectations wins and succeeds so wildly that his friends, his family, and a whole nation has to celebrate him. When I first met Bob Collymore, he had two strikes against him. The first one was he had to fill the shoes of the phenomenal, visionary, committed, fiery, blunt Michael Joseph. Who could? The second strike against him, I'd rather not talk about, but you know it. But Bob did not fill the shoes of his friend Michael. He made his own shoes. He wove the shoes, he handmade them with his relentless commitment to work. But more than that was his commitment to excellence. He created a higher and much more noble purpose for Safaricom. His passion was to serve his customers intimately every day. And he did serve his customers and Kenyans every day. His mission, beyond the amazing profitability of his company Safaricom and the constant stream of dividends to government, to the taxman, and to his shareholders, his mission was to serve the society he lived in, to change lives, and to build his employees forever. And when you met him, you felt it. Bob made everybody, including his people at Safaricom, want to aspire to be better people and to be better human beings. And he did this with his amazing humility, his humanity, his deep warmth, his unvarnished honesty, and above all, his sense of purpose. Mr. President and friends, very few business people I know in Africa, in Kenya and the world, create products that make our lives genuinely better, so that they become such an integral part of our society that we cannot think about them not being there. Bob made Safaricom an intimate and inseparable part of our lives. He made it the enabler of our lives. We wake up with Safaricom. We share our love on Safaricom. We cry our tears and dreams on Safaricom. We transact our business on Safaricom. We pay our salaries on Safaricom. And we give funeral contributions on Safaricom. But of course, Job, my friend said, don't contribute anything. More than that, we share our promotions, our laughters, our joy, and even our emojis on Safaricom. He also did something truly uncommon. He forged a wonderful bond where the people privileged to meet him knew that from the streets to the boardrooms, from the lowest in our society to presidents, when you met him, he changed you. He used to come to my office and call me and say to me, you work in the shadows, but I need you to help me change this country. He was perhaps the greatest advocate for you, Mr. President, and you probably didn't know. I mean, he'd call me some days and say, you know, that article was wrong. That's my friend. You can't do that. And he would chastise me for a whole hour. I forgave him because he was Bob Collymore. We shared our burdens together. I got to know him well. I realized he collected African art. I do. He loved jazz. I do. But beyond that, this guy, when he held a saxophone, was like a child with a lollipop. He was just unbelievable. You saw another side of him. He caused all his friends to change. He made us more human, like himself, more willing, more open, more vulnerable. And he got me and a bunch of really straight-up guys to unbutton our shirts and relax and be kids again in the presence of each other. He made us people of purpose. He would come to me and call me and say, you know, Kenyans are starving. We need to do Kenyans for Kenya. And I need you behind me, because if you don't stand with me, your other colleagues won't. And he'll literally drag me and say, I want an announcement every hour. In fact, every 15 minutes. And I'd do it. So together with the media, we really battled for Kenya. I'll miss him. And I'll miss him very much, because last Saturday at 3 p.m., Peter Kenneth, Alikan Sachu, Barat Takra, Jeff Koinange, and I had our last meeting with him. And Joshua Oigara was on the line in his living room. And after many things, he said to me, I don't know about this heaven and earth thing. I really don't know about this life after death thing. But I really, really hope there's life after death. So I said, and what do you mean by that? And if you met him, he's got a twinkle in his eye. So he goes, if there are ghosts, I will come and rustle the curtains. On the birthdays, when you light a candle for my kids, I'll come and blow it and it'll go off. And you light it again and I'll blow it. And you light it again and I'll blow it. That's the man we lost. Calmly, he told us, if I get 3 more days, I'll be lucky. We asked him what we must do. And he said, stay together and stand by one boy. At the next boys' club dinner on the 19th of July, we will set a place for our captain, as we called him, and raise our glasses, knowing he has changed Kenya and ourselves forever. For Wamboi and the kids, all I can say is you gave him a new purpose in life, and you added an amazing spring to his step. As I end today, for those of us, and for those of you who are natural-born Kenyans, and for those of us who are foreign-born but Kenyan by choice, I say this. The question Bob Collymore asks of us is this: what deposit do you leave for your country? Thank you.
Wambui, Bob's family, Your Excellencies, friends, good afternoon. A great life is like a note of music in a cathedral. It might come from one place or one voice, but it echoes, it resonates everywhere in the building. And as I go around Kenya, as we all go around this wonderful country, we hear those echoes, we hear that resonance of Bob. We see how it has changed people's lives. The Mama Mboga that gets up at 3 a.m., borrows a few hundred bob on M-Pesa to buy some stock, sells it in the market, makes a small profit, pays the loan back when she puts her kids to bed, and does that little bit better as a result. In the young innovator who uses the platform that Bob created to do some of the most exciting and innovative and clever things with technology that are done anywhere in the world, here in Kenya. In the young musician who leaves some of the poorest households in Kenya and comes on a Sunday afternoon to play their instrument along with their friends to find joy and purpose and creativity in their lives. I hear those resonances, Bob, of you everywhere that I go, and we hear them around the world in the work that you did with the United Nations, in the stand that you took against corruption, in the connections that you forged between people and countries. Because yes, Bob, you belonged to Kenya, but you were my compatriot too, as well as my friend, and you did so much to connect my country, our country, with this great country of Kenya, and to show what can be done through those connections. Now, in some great lives, that voice, that note of music, it's about drawing attention, it's about amplification, it's about saying, hey, here I am. Not with Bob. Bob didn't mind who took the credit. I remember when we launched a new team with the Kenyan police to track down people who abuse children online. And I called Bob and he said, great, we'll give them free comms, we'll give them access to all the data they need so they can find these people and track them down. He never got any credit for that. He didn't mind. What mattered was making a difference. Our brother Charles Musando talked about the disability summit that we hosted with Kenya last year in London. And sure, Bob came along, as was described, but he also went back to Safaricom and said, let's make this the best place in Kenya for people with disabilities to work. And he set new targets, and those people came in, and he harnessed those talents. When we look back at the lives that we remember in our world, it's not the longest lives that we remember, but the ones that made the biggest impact. Just like it's not the longest note of music that echoes most, but the one that is brightest and strongest. And Bob, you were that bright and strong note of music. You will echo and resonate in our lives for as long as we live them, and in the lives of millions of others. And you brought us together in a great chord, a great resonant chord of working together to make a difference in this world. And for that, we thank you. May God comfort your family. May God rest your soul in peace. And may he give us all courage to pursue the work that you undertook. Thank you very much.
We're going to have three more tributes before I hand back to the very Reverend Canon Sammy Wainaina. First up, Mr. Nicholas Nganga, Chairman Safaricom. He'll be followed by Peter Kenneth, speaking on behalf of Friends of Bob Collymore. And after that will be Principal Secretary and member of the Safaricom Board, Esther Koimet, representing the government. Mr. Nganga.
Mrs. Wambui Collymore and family, Your Excellency, the President of Kenya, and Excellency, First Lady, Excellency, the Deputy President, and all other protocols observed. It is difficult to say anything today that has not been said or will not be said, but as they say, a good story bears repeating. I stand here representing the board of directors that had not only worked closely with Bob, but also grown very fond of him over the years. The Bob we knew was not your average man. Even while enduring intense rounds of treatment the kind of treatment that would have left many younger people weaker. Bob would make the effort to look unruffled, unperturbed, and presentable, I suppose as a way of showing the amount of respect he had for himself as well as for whoever he was meeting. Today, we feel like to have to make effort to pull ourselves together, to remain stoic, even in the face of extraordinary grief. Even though he repeatedly said that he was going to go, and we have no choice but to accept that he is gone, we may not be ready in our minds to say goodbye. Yet we must, because we must control our sorrow and humbly accept God's will. In accepting this, I pray that we find the strength to celebrate Bob's life, because that is what he would have wanted us to do. Bob was a man who the board trusted to deliver on the promises he made, none of which compromised his beliefs. Over the last 9 years, we saw these beliefs slowly evolve from a single person's dreams to do good and into a company's purpose to transform lives. He worked hard to achieve Safaricom's objectives, and more often than not, surpassed the targets that had been agreed with us at the board on business, because he also believes that this is how companies grow. Bob often said he was interested in numbers, but this belies the truth. The truth being that he understood business very well. It was because he truly believed that people meant more than profit, that purpose, people and profit did not have to be mutually exclusive. We have all seen how well he steered Safaricom, and the board and shareholders were more than impressed with his performance. We particularly appreciate the efforts he made to continue giving leadership to the company, even when his body was severely ravaged by disease. I can say with confidence that not many CEOs would stand up for people the way Bob did. Whether it was for his customers, employees, or beneficiaries of Safaricom's community projects, Bob loved people. He fought for people to get a fair deal, whether in terms of salaries and bonuses for staff, or in terms of product accessibility to customers. Bob was committed to inclusion and to ensuring that Safaricom contributed towards reducing inequalities in society in whichever way we could. I can recall in 2017 when Bob insisted that we launch M-Pesa Kadogo. We all thought it was a bad idea and told him so. We thought it was a bad idea to make people transact anything below 100 shillings on M-Pesa for free. But Bob reminded us that M-Pesa was a success, not because of the people who could afford to carry out large transactions, but because of those who transacted the little amount every day, something I'm sure a lot of the businessmen present here today understand very well. It was not about selling all the time. It was about creating accessibility to the opportunities provided by modern necessities, such as mobile connectivity and data, and doing so with integrity and transparency. Bob liked to say he wasn't perfect, and this was true. Nobody is. But he was our perfectly imperfect CEO. He's a man who did not shy away from admitting when he had failed or when he was struggling to get things right. He wasn't afraid of apologizing when he was wrong or when he failed those he promised to serve. Not many people in his position would do that. And it's a quality that endeared him to many and earned the confidence of the board and the management. If there was anything that Bob hated, and I hope people understood this, it was any hint of dishonesty, fraud, or corruption against which he would take the most drastic actions. So today, ladies and gentlemen, we honor the memory of a man who believed in the equality of all, a man who made it his duty to ensure that men, women, and all people with disabilities would have the same opportunities. He had strong belief in inclusivity, which he often described as doing more than inviting someone to the ball. To Bob, real inclusivity meant inviting them to the ball and asking them to dance. We saw it in his style of leadership and his uncanny power to convene business leaders and others in order to advocate a cause for more inclusive business practices or for the welfare of the people. Just recently in May, he brought together a host of chief executives from different industries to discuss shared value. They did not send their representatives. They chose to join him there because he was the kind of man who made you want to listen, to share ideas, and to do more. Bob's passing leaves a gap we cannot easily fill. But in this loss lies the opportunity to honor his legacy by completing the work he began and which he so passionately espoused, from deepening financial inclusion in communities inside and beyond Kenya's borders through M-Pesa and other services, to supporting sports and the arts, to spearheading efforts to achieve gender equality and create more inclusive and sustainable business models. In Bob, Safaricom had a visionary leader, a courageous man, and it is with that same vision and courage that we must approach the future. As I conclude, I wish to leave us with two indications of Bob's wide visionary mind. In discussions on the vexing question of dominance, Bob stated that instead of Kenyans fighting about one successful enterprise, what they should be trying to do is build 10 other companies like Safaricom. In various discussions also, Bob strongly reminded the board that Safaricom had long ceased to be a mere telco and had become a platform for providing solutions in such diverse areas as education, agriculture, health, and business. Quote, "We are a platform that is enabling enterprise, creating wealth for shareholders, giving back to communities, and empowering Kenyans," unquote. Right now, although it feels as if a light in our life has been dimmed, I believe that this spirit will continue to light the way for us, guiding us to achieve the vision Bob so passionately articulated. To his wife, Wambui, and their children, and the rest of his family, thank you for sharing the gift of Bob with us. We stand with you. We will continue to pray for you and to support you in whatever way we can, because we are family. On behalf of the Safaricom Board of Directors, management, and staff, I say thank you to everyone who has taken time and effort to condole with us, and there have been many. Let us all stand strong, find strength in each other, and maintain our commitment to Bob's vision, our vision of transforming lives. And so, as we commit Bob to the care of God's hands, we also will keep his memory in the rich, exceptional legacy he has left us. May his soul rest in peace. Thank you.
Your Excellency, the President of the Republic of Kenya, Her Excellency, First Lady, Your Excellency, the Deputy President, the entire political class, our younger sister, Mrs. Wambui Kolimo, and the entire family, the Provost, and the entire clergy, it is a singular honor and privilege to have been asked to pay tribute on behalf of Bob's friends. Bob had many friends in all sectors and across all spheres. The outpouring of grief following his demise has been overwhelming. Young and old, male and female, from all walks of life. Bob has been mourned with a heart-wrenching sincerity. Without a doubt, he touched many, many lives. Bob was a gentleman, humble to core, an honest and loyal friend. He was down to earth. Often he'd look us up or get us to look for each other. Bob would ask, "Have you spoken to PQ lately?" I would call Patrick, only to learn that he was struggling with a sick relative abroad. It was Bob's way of reminding us to be there for each other. As we prepared to usher in 2019, he knew I was struggling with somebody very close in ICU. He had himself just suffered a relapse. I was in no mood to celebrate, but he encouraged me to get out, and we joined Churchill at his new year show at Garden City. It turned out to be a wonderful evening and a great start to the new year. You may have in the recent past read or heard about the Boys Club. These were no boys, but some old men. In fact, the youngest was Jeff Koinange. So you can imagine how old the others were. But there were about 10 or so who Bob brought together and hosted every Tuesday whenever possible. Many are with us this morning. Some have traveled from far and wide. Only on very rare occasions and following extreme persuasion did Bob allow a few members to host the boys' club outside his home. Our get-togethers were full of laughter, and during one such get-together, the name Kihara was given to him. When we next visited his house, Wamboi had put a name up on the signpost showing their way to their home. He drew us into many projects which he was supporting, like the Josephine Kulea Initiative to protect young girls in Samburu, and the Ice Bucket Challenge. He dutifully invited us to the annual Safaricom Jazz Festival. Bob had many other personal interests. He was a helicopter pilot. He encouraged me to learn how to fly one and discreetly followed up with the training captain on my progress. At one boys club get together, he teased me about my first solo flight on my own. We flew together a couple of times. He was a serious pilot and would warn me not to crack any jokes, otherwise would end up going down. Bob loved music. He liked playing instruments and was a keen supporter of local musicians. He challenged me to take up the sax, and we planned a collab at a surprise during one of the jazz festivals. I learned how to play the sax, but unfortunately the collab was not to be. Maybe when we meet again, we'll do it. He was a hilarious man. When any of the boys met him in London, he insisted on introducing them to his tailor, a certain Ghanaian called Boateng. I vividly remember one occasion when he was fitting a new suit, and he asked his tailor to sell the rest of our suits. The price was beyond our budgets. So we politely told the tailor that we would return at a later time. Bob did not comment. On our way to dinner that evening, we stopped at a car showroom where I showed him what I thought was a nice car. That is when he vented his frustration at our not buying suits from his favorite tailor, quipping that the car was worth an awful lot of suits. The next morning, in his humor, he empesaed me 1,000 shillings as a startup fund for buying the car. On another occasion at some European capital, we got together for drinks with a bunch of friends. At the entrance where we were gathering, we were asked for what was by any standard an excessive cover charge. He made us leave in a huff, saying that he was not going to pay a cover charge four times the cost of drinks that we were going to take. From October 2017, when he was diagnosed with AML, we made it our duty to visit him wherever he was. Whether it was at Nairobi Hospital, Guy's Hospital, near Russell Square, or Euston in London. When he eventually came home, the boys' club took up the responsibility, together with Wamboi's friends, under a group that Wamboi formed, known as Healers Group, to donate platelets that is so much needed. Jeff Koinange became Mr. Platelets because of his high count, until the baton of donating the platelets was passed to our children, and Jeff lost the title. Bob was brave to the end. It was not his wish for us to grieve. Tuesday last week, Bob invited us for a regular boys' club meeting. He was relaxed and was joyful. And so we were taken aback when he broke the sad news that he had only a couple of weeks at best to live. He walked us through his journey and assured us that he was at peace. He eventually went into his whiskey store and opened a very special reserve blended whiskey that he had saved many years for a special guest. He insisted we become the special guest, and he insisted that we all share the whiskey, even for those who don't drink whiskey. Then he saw us. He saw every one of us off individually. Little did we know it would be the last boys' club meeting with him. We did not want to leave the next visit for Tuesday this week, and so we insisted and agreed to meet him on Friday for tea last week. He later cancelled Friday because he was tired. On Saturday morning, we all woke up to a pleasant surprise. He had asked us for tea at 3 p.m. He was jovial, albeit in some pain. He told us what he wanted for his final journey and requested us, through one of the boys, Barrett, to oversee the cremation. Many of the members of the Boys Club traveled out of the country after the Saturday meeting. We still believed we had some time with him. On Monday, we all woke up at various destinations to the shocking news of his demise. We remain grateful to Patrick Kwaku, who responded to Wambui's call at 3 in the morning and quickly got the message to the rest of us. I had just gotten to the DRC on Sunday night and woke up to find Wambui's attempted call to me. Joshua Igara was in New York. Lamin had just gone back to Nigeria. We all turned back immediately to fulfill his wishes. We owed this much to a man we recognized as our captain. On Saturday, while we were there, and I think it's only fair that I say this, while he was taking us through, he also took us through two of his visitors last week. To Michael Joseph, Bob was overwhelmed by your emotions when you visited him on Wednesday. He reminded us of a similar scene in London a year ago when the two of you had gone out for dinner and you came back and you couldn't leave each other's hands. And I saw the difficulties you were. He had similar difficulties on his emotions about you. To His Excellency the President, it was very clear you visited him on Monday just to see how he was doing. But he felt you gave him an opportunity to explain what he was going through and how many days he had. He remained very grateful. To Wambui and family, thank you for being there for Bob in good times and for taking care of him with such devotion throughout his sickness. Many times we saw you in London at home and we knew what you were going through. We reminded him on Saturday what you've always told us. You were not there, but whatever you've always told us, that if you were to do it again, it would be him. He smiled and the pain went away. Thank you for welcoming us into your home and lives, Wambui. We will always be there for you. In conclusion, Bob died at the age of 61. He touched many lives. He had only been in Kenya for about 10 years. What a great example and lesson for all of us here today who have lived in Kenya over 10 years. Fare thee well, our captain. We remain ever so grateful to God for the gift of your life.
Wambui Kolimo and members of your family, our President, Your Excellency Uhuru Kenyatta, our First Lady, Your Excellency Margaret Kenyatta, our Deputy President, Your Excellency William Ruto, the Provost, dear friends, all protocols observed. I have represented the government for a long time on the Safaricom. And I first met Bob when he joined the board, and that was at the time that we were doing the restructuring. Many of you may not remember, but Safaricom started as a department of Telkom, and then when it became a company, Telkom held 60% of the shares and Vodafone held the other 40. And so when we were restructuring Telkom, we made the decision to move those shares from Telkom to the Kenya government. And it involved a lot of shareholder discussions, and the decision was also made to list 25% of the out of that 60. And some of the shareholder discussions were very difficult. But having Bob on the board was very helpful, because we could, where we had difficulties in those shareholder discussions, talk to Bob aside and explain to him why the government was taking the decisions it was taking and why it was important for the structure to be the way the government wanted. And so he supported us. He would go, he would talk to his shareholder, the shareholder he represented. He would then call me and he would say, it's sorted. And we would move like that. And when we did the Safaricom IPO, that relationship continued. Whenever we had issues that we needed to discuss at shareholder level, he would always be the person that we turned to help our partner understand us better. And so we say, thank you, Bob. And then it came time to get somebody to take over from Michael. And as has been said, Michael's shoes were big shoes. And Safaricom was already an important company and a company that was growing. And we needed someone who would make sure that this Safaricom continued in its trajectory of growth. We wanted someone who would not do harm to the company. And I remember the board created a nomination committee that involved the chairman, Michael, and myself. And when I saw the short list of the candidates, I was actually surprised that Michael's name was there, because for the life of me, I had not seen Michael in that role. But when we interviewed the candidates, we realized Bob was the one who understood Safaricom. He understood what Michael calls the DNA of Safaricom. And so we knew he would look after this company and he would grow it. And true to form, when Bob came, as has been said, he obviously decided to chart his own course, because Michael's shoes were too big, but he wanted to create his own shoes and make his own shoes. And what we saw was somebody who became very people-centered. And what that people-centeredness meant was that he created his team, he strengthened his team, he built that team to be an all-inclusive team, he ensured that women were recognized, were promoted, were holding more senior positions. He ensured that people with disability was brought on board, as has been we've been told. He ensured that young mothers could bring their children to work, so he created a creche, and he just made his people feel cared for, feel understood by their leader, feel that they had somebody that would understand them and with whom they could work to build the company. It also meant that he was very close to his customers. He became very customer-centric. He made his team understand the need to go to the shop floor, to walk on the streets of Nairobi and meet customers, to get into matatus, to get into shops. And he did all this by leading, by being the leader that actually did what he said, leading by example. And he also had a great way of managing his shareholders. And so he was always close to us. In the stakeholder group, the Kenya government is many things. The Kenya government is a shareholder, so you know all those relationships with the National Treasury. The Kenya government is a policy maker, and so all the ICT-related discussions with the Ministry of the ICT. The Kenya government is a customer. And the Kenya government also has a political side, all those meetings in parliament and all the relationship that needed to be managed. And he managed them so easily. We didn't even realize, you know, he would call you and say, we need to meet. He'd come to, you know, to the office. We'd go to the minister, we'd go to the CS, and he would go as high as he needed to go. And you can see that he even created his own personal relationship with His Excellency, who at one time, of course, was his shareholder as the Minister for Finance. And so we got a leader that was very, very involved with understanding, creating networks, and so on. And as a finance person, we always believe in numbers. So let me share with you a few numbers. When Bob came in 2010, we had 15.8 million customers. He doubled that number. By the time he went to be with the Lord, we had 32 million customers. Our turnover grew by 199% from 83.9 billion to 250.9 billion. Our net income grew by 319%, growing from 15.1 billion in 2010 to 63.3 billion in 2019. And somebody spoke about the taxman. The total tax that was paid to the Kenya government during his tenure was 565 billion shillings. It tripled essentially from 29 billion annually to almost 100 billion annually. The dividends that came to the people of Kenya, to the government, were 77.5 billion. And that does not include the proposed dividends that will be placed before the shareholders this September of 26.2 billion. Our share price hovered around 2.75 shillings to 6 shillings in the first year of his service, and it reached a high of 30.5 shillings this year, making a valuation of the company to rise from the 2 billion at which we floated the company to 11.2 billion, and those are dollars. So from 200 billion shillings to 1.1 trillion shillings. M-Pesa, at the time it took over, transacted 814 billion a year in that year. It's risen to 11.7 trillion shillings, essentially a trillion shillings a month, the M-Pesa transactions. So you can see the impact that this man has had, his leadership has had on the company and on the people of Kenya. Esther spoke here about the customers, his agents, and there are so many businesses that have been created because he managed Safaricom in such a way that it became embedded in the Kenyan economy. And he also had a social impact on many people. He was just an ordinary guy, a guy who went to the streets, somebody who took us to jazz, somebody who developed this young musical talent that is in this country, somebody who touched all lives. He introduced Wi-Fi in matatus just so that the common man was able also to transact business on his commute to work. So today we honor a great man. We honor a family man, a leader, a friend to whom we owe a debt of gratitude. And so we say, thank you very much, Bob. Asante sana, umetenda wema, umeenda zako, lala salama, Bob.
We've done very well, and we need to bring this to an end. But just before we watch a video, and then later invite His Excellency, the Deputy and the President, to bring their condolences and to eulogize this great man, allow me to give this time. Thank you for your patience. Kindly remain patient. I know the service is getting longer than we thought, but I think this is the day we celebrate Bob. And so, Wamboi, I would like to invite you now to give your message before we listen to a video.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Bob liked to quote His Excellency John Mahama, who once told him of power and succession that one must leave when the applause is loudest. Bob left when the applause was loudest. There is a man I would like to thank for reminding me in the midst of my grief that Bob was a different sort of person. On Tuesday, as our convoy made its way to Kariokor for Bob's cremation, an elderly gentleman in a bright orange jacket stood on the side of the road, raised his right arm in the air in salute. As our convoy slowed down, he shouted, "Bob, we love you. You have done well. Go well, Bob." It was someone that I will probably never meet again, a Kenyan like myself who felt that his duty that morning was to stand on the side of the road and announce to the world that Bob had left a mark in his life. Nothing more. This morning, I'd like to read a speech to you that Bob gave to a group of eager children. I have adapted it a little to suit today's celebration. The message is simple but important, and one that I feel epitomizes the idea behind the man I fondly called Mr. Collymore. The story is lifted from Horton Hears a Who by Dr. Seuss, a speech by Bob Collymore in 2013. A person's a person, no matter how small. One of my favorite stories is about an elephant that hears little people on a speck of dust shouting for help. The elephant does everything in his power to protect the speck of dust because the little people who live on that speck of dust have asked for his help. In a gentle way, the elephant sets out to help the little people. The elephant places the speck of dust on a clover so that he can carry the speck to safety. But no one else can hear the voices coming from the speck of dust on the clover. Not the kangaroo and his baby kangaroo, not the monkeys or the eagle or any of the other larger animals in the jungle. He is made fun of by the kangaroo, and eventually the clover with the speck of dust is taken from him by a troop of monkeys and carried away by a swift eagle. Eventually, the unforgiving eagle throws the clover with the little people on it into a huge field of clovers. The poor elephant, who has been chasing after the eagle, searches and searches all 3 million clovers in that field, night and day, until he finds his clover with a speck of dust and the little people on it. The elephant does not rest until he is sure that the little people are safe. The elephant refuses to give up on little people, even though everyone else around him has. He stands by what he believes and defends it. He defends little people even when the animals threaten to cage the elephant for hearing the small voices. When I was a little boy, my grandmother took in children whose parents could not take care of them. I remember sharing a bed with children and sometimes waking up when none of them had peed in bed. Growing up, I had little brothers and sisters who I wasn't related to, except through love. My grandmother was like the elephant that heard the noise from the small people on that speck of dust. She didn't have much. We were poor, but she reminded me that whatever little we had, we could always share it. She did this because a person's a person, no matter how small. I look out at you this morning. I wonder, do you want what is best for this world? Well, you see, wanting what is best for this world isn't only about saving the world. It's also about the little things that you can do to make a big difference. It's about helping because you can. The company I work for, Safaricom, helps people because it can. We go out of our way to bring fresh water to villages that don't have it. We take medical camps to places where there are no hospitals. We build schools where children are being taught under a tree. We work in those schools because we can make a difference. We know that selling airtime has no value if the world cannot be a better place. We work with those students because we want the best for our world by giving those students the opportunity to be whatever they dream about becoming. It is not because their parents refuse it for them. It is because we live in a world where some people have a lot and some people have very little. It is a blessing to have a lot. It is a blessing to have a roof over your head, shoes on your feet, food for your stomach, and a bed to get into tonight. But the biggest blessing is that you can do a lot with what you have, no matter your size. You can do a lot because you can do a lot, especially for others who don't have very much. In my favorite story about the elephant and the speck of dust, the elephant is big and has the ability to make people listen, and he uses that ability. He knows he has to protect the people smaller than him on that speck of dust because a person's a person, no matter how small. And the thing is, you're never too small to make a difference in this world. At the end of my favorite story, the elephant is able to save the little people because the smallest of them speaks out and yells for help. In the end, it is the voice of the smallest person on that small speck of dust that saves all the little people and the elephant. Sometimes, all you have to do is to speak up when you think something is not fair. Speaking up is the basic idea of activism. It is calling something out that is wrong so that you can find a way to change it, to make it right. Speaking out is one way of making things right. Doing what we can is another way. We can do a lot by being considerate of our friends and family, our neighbors, our little brothers and sisters, and our surroundings. We need to remember to see each other, to say hello, and to say thank you. Being considerate means caring how you treat yourself, others, and what is around you. You have to be gentle. The big elephant could easily have crunched the speck of dust with little people on it. He was so big that he couldn't see the little people, but he was gentle with them, and this is what saved them. But being kind and considerate to others can make you stand out in an unexpected way. As you begin to shine because you know what you want and you stand for what you believe in, you will start to meet more and more people who will not like you. There will be those who will envy you, those who make fun of you, those who try to make you feel guilty for being who you are. So here's my advice. Never be ashamed of who you are. Never apologize for what you have. Never let people decide how you should feel about yourself. Be proud of yourself and your achievements. Believe in yourself first. Stand up for what you believe in. Speak out when you think something is not fair. Be considerate to those around you, especially for who and what is smaller than you, because a person's a person, no matter how small. Ordinarily, when we pay respect to those we love, we give 1 minute of silence. Bob has chosen to give us all 8 minutes of music. The piece that is about to play, Adagio for Strings by Samuel Barber, was his request for his memorial and a gift to you all.
It is now my honor and pleasure to welcome the Deputy President, Dr. William Ruto, who will in return welcome His Excellency the President. Kindly welcome.
Your Excellency, President Uhuru Kenyatta, Your Excellency, First Lady, Wambui Kolimo, the mother and the family, the Right Honorable Tony Blair, former Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, former Vice President Moody Awori, former Vice President Musalia Mudavadi, former Vice President Kalonzo Musyoka, political leaders present, church leaders, business leaders, ladies and gentlemen. The last time I had an interaction with Bob Kolimo was about a month ago when he visited me with a friend. And I know the family has said that we should not mourn but celebrate the life of Bob Kolimo. And indeed, it is a celebration of a life very well lived. But it is difficult to reconcile Bob Kolimo, who we all knew had this terminal condition and that he had not long to live. But when you met Bob Kolimo, he behaved, he interacted as though he was going to live forever. It was quite a paradox. And it goes to demonstrate his courage and what he stood and lived for. Bob Kolimo was not just a business leader in Kenya. He was not just a successful corporate business leader in Kenya. He inspired and influenced government policy. Allow me to just mention two occasions. On one occasion, when we were thinking about our education system and the reform that was required in our education system and our re-engineering of our education so that it responds more to the needs of industry, that inspired us to think about technical education, competence-based education, as is being rolled out now. Bob Kolimo became a big source of inspiration because here came a man without a university degree who ran successfully the most profitable enterprise in Kenya. On a second occasion, sometime in 2014, His Excellency President Uhuru Kenyatta was leading us through the process of thinking about how we can reform our police and what we needed to do to improve the conditions of service for our policemen. And we went through various motions to look at their insurance, to look at many of the aspects that contribute to their conditions of service. And I remember having this discussion with a former IG, and we got to a stage when we had done many of the things, and we ran into a situation that we could not manage because we were informed by our police that they have an old communication system that sometimes even criminals had a way of listening in. And so something needed to be done. When we explained to His Excellency the President, he told us, leave this one to me. I will have a chat with my friend Bob Kolimo. The rest is history. The result is that today we have a modern camera surveillance system and a modern police communication system. That is how far Bob Kolimo influenced government policy. And so it is a befitting occasion for us to celebrate this great person who became a Kenyan, probably more Kenyan than many of us. And of course, Bob Kolimo was extraordinary, because apart from all the time that he spent making sure that Safaricom was ahead of the game, was a business leader, was making profit, he also had time for art and music, which was his passion. And of course, I agree with Joshua, who said here that jazz and classical music is quite a scale up in terms of music in Kenya. Joshua said, for the people who think about rumba, and Kofi Olomide and that group, it was quite something. And of course, it was more to those of us who our international scope of music was Mwanza Town Choir. And choir ya Morogoro. So it was quite something for us. And apart from what he did in Safaricom, he introduced us to some things which are new. And as has been said by many people here, Bob Kolimo is in a class of his own. And we celebrate his life and the moments that he spent with us, to the family. Bob's courage and the way he did things should be an inspiration to you as a family to look at the situation before you with the courage of Bob and know the things he held dear and carry his legacy into the future. Before I request His Excellency the President to make his remarks, let me, on behalf of all the other leaders here, request with a lot of humility the former Prime Minister of the UK to come and make some remarks. Your Excellency, Tony Blair. Sorry for the ambush. It was instructions from the president.
Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, Wambui, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's actually a great honor for me to say a few words in memory of Bob. When I was preparing to come to Kenya earlier this week, and I heard the news of Bob's passing, I immediately wrote a letter to Wambui, and my office said to me, "So who was this person?" He was the head of a telecom company. And I said, "Yes, he was. He was the head of a telecom company. And he was a great head of a telecom company. But much more important, he was a great human being and a wonderful example of how a good life can be led." So what I remember about Bob from my conversations with him, oh, one other thing, by the way, I know that tailor the man spoke about. I actually did have a conversation with Bob once about that tailor. I know that tailor. I use that tailor. He's a great tailor. But my wife, who is a believer in equality, is still buying clothes on the basis of that tailor's suits. So Bob was someone who was a great leader. And he was a great leader because he was unafraid to take positions, unafraid to stand up for what he believed, but also because he was an effective man. He got things done. He knew what his challenges were. He set out to meet them, and he met them. So when we remember him today, my thought as I've sat here and listened to all these speeches is the following: that you can die in old age and frail, and people look back on your life and they will remember many of the things that you have done. But when you die in the prime of life, people are remembering you as if you were still there and with us, as if you were still a vibrant human being before us. And all I can say is that for any of us here, when our time comes, as it surely and must will come, if we are able to provoke even a fraction as much sincerity in admiration, genuine grief at loss, and genuine celebration at example, we will be very lucky indeed. Thank you so much for having me here.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's now my pleasure to request His Excellency the President of the Republic of Kenya to come and eulogize his friend. Your Excellency, sir.
Please be seated. Thank you. Wambui, the kids, the entire Kolimo family, fellow mourners, I'm here today, first and foremost, to join all of you in celebrating a great life, a man who one can say truly lived life, and live that life not just in service of himself, his family, but in service of society. Bob was a man born in Guyana, yes, traveled via the United Kingdom to various destinations across the globe, but finally set foot and settled in Kenya 10 years ago. And he has made a contribution as some have said here, greater than many who are born, bred, and lived in Kenya throughout their lives. There's three things I can say Bob loved. A fourth one I can also say, but I don't want to mention that here. Amongst many other things. But I am certain Bob loved Kenya. He loved it as his home country. Bob loved Safaricom as if it was his own, a part of his family. And Bob loved his wife and his children dearly. Like I said, the fourth one I won't mention, but some of you here know what it is. We have lost a friend. We have lost a part of our soul. And even as we celebrate, there is still pain of being left by somebody who cared so passionately about the things that he did. About 3 weeks ago, I was on a trip to Canada. Time differences and everything. So at some strange hour, consistent, you know, I said, for 2 days in a row, 2 o'clock in the morning, registered, called Bob Collymore, I was wondering. So on the second day, I picked it up and I'm asking him, you know, Bob, why are you calling me at 2 o'clock in the morning? He says, ah, I didn't realize you were traveling. So I said, yeah, I am, and it's 2 o'clock in the morning where I am, so can I call you when I get back? And he says, no, I've got something quite urgent I want to discuss with you, but I suppose I can wait until you get back. But I just wanted to tell you, I made you a promise that I'd hang on for another year with the company, but I think I'm going to break that promise. So I told him why. I said, we'll talk about it when you get back. I started asking myself a couple of questions and says, but please don't tell anybody what I've just said. We'll talk about it when you're back. So I get back. I give him a call. Ah, you're back. I said, yeah. So I went over to the house. Found him there, calm. Oh, how's everything? Everything's fine. But like I said, I'm going to have to break my promise. And he's saying it with a smile on his face. So I thought, ah, Wambui has put you under pressure, you know. As he kept telling me, I don't think Wambui will allow me. But so I said, she succeeded, right? He says, no, it's not quite that. But I don't think I have more than a couple of weeks to go. So I said, but, you know, you've still a lot of things that we can try and do. How can we? He said, no, I've given up. I've tried everything. And I have accepted that my time has come. So we spent a whole afternoon. And my biggest thing was, you know, why are you talking to me about Safaricom, about... What about you? I says, no, my chapter is closed. And I have accepted it. So all I want to know is, how is the future of this company? What is its future? What's going to happen? And we spent almost 3-4 hours talking about nothing else but what he saw as his vision, his hope for the company, his dreams and what he thought I should be focused on in terms of my own legacy as President of the Republic, the focus on the focus on corruption. And the fight that must be won, the issue of How do we deal with the moral fabric of our society that has collapsed? You know, at the end of the day, I said, you know, Bob, are you sure you want to continue? He said, no. If you're not in a rush, I'm not in a rush. Let's continue. And we had a wonderful, wonderful afternoon together. And when we finished, I asked him, so what can I do for you? You can't do anything for me. I don't need anything. I've sorted out my life. I've sorted out my issues. But the only thing you can do for me is make sure that you all take care of Wambui and the kids. That's all I want. I'm not interested in anything else. Well, we're here, and it's finally happened. I've lost a very good friend. My one disappointment, I was supposed to have gone back to collect something that had been reserved for a special friend. So Peter, Kenneth, Aigara and crew, you have to pay. That didn't belong to you. But say that we have lost a great friend, a champion for Kenya, a champion for young people, a champion for the arts. May the Almighty God rest his soul in eternal peace. Thank you very much.
Can you remain standing for a second or few? I want you to stretch your legs. I know you've been tired, but we are bringing this to an end. Now take your seat, please. Thank you very much for all the tributes. They have taken long, but they were very important. I don't think we'll invite you here again to do this. There are many lessons that we can learn from Bob, and I think the greatest gift that we can give him is to live as he lived. The greatest tragedy in life is not to die. No, that's not the greatest tragedy. The greatest tragedy is to live a life without purpose and to die a life without purpose. And I think what I've heard today is that Bob lived and died a life of purpose. Let me now invite Jessica and Jacob to do the first and second readings.
From Matthew 5:13 to 16, from the NIV version. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything, except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven.
Our second reading is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 11 to 16, from the Message version. Don't waste your time on useless work, mere busy work, the barren pursuits of darkness. Expose these things for the sham they are. It's a scandal when people waste their lives on things they must do in the darkness where no one will see. Rip the cover off those frauds and see how attractive they look in the light of Christ. May our Lord's name be praised.
Yesterday afternoon, I had time, about an hour and a half, to talk to one boy, the mother, and the sister. And I had wonderful things about Bob. His desire was his service to be done here at All Saints, and for us, it's an honor. And we don't just want you to remember Bob. I want you, as you leave this church, to remember that there's a greater person than Bob, and that was the Creator, and that is God Himself. If we forget this, we will have lost everything. And so I'll not preach. I've asked my deputy, the Reverend Evans Omolo, to bring the homily. And so I request you to stand. And we will sing three stanzas of the hymn, Amazing Grace.
Lord, we thank you this afternoon for giving us an opportunity to celebrate a great man in the history of our country and a revolutionist in the telecommunications industry, our dear friend and brother Bob. And as we reflect and have reflected on his life, and as we pick from the wealth of your word, may you speak to our hearts and encourage us to face life boldly and to shine the life of Jesus that you call us to. In Jesus' name we pray. I invite us to please take our seats. To the Provost of All Saints Cathedral, Canon Sami, who is my boss, who hired me as a young man to support him in steering the ministry of this cathedral. I appreciate you for being unselfish and granting me this opportunity to share God's word as we celebrate Bob. As the deputy president did mention, you know, when you're a deputy, you only take instructions. He too does take instructions from the president. And to Omboy and your family, our very sincere condolences to both sides of your family. And to Mr. President, we appreciate you and all the political leaders who have come alongside other fellow mourners to celebrate Bob here this afternoon. Mr. President, as I share a homily in encouragement to all of us, you remember that it's our very delight always to host you here at the Cathedral. And in November 2017, on the 5th, we did host you here as we celebrated 100 years of Cathedral's existence. And right on the seat where you're seated, you first shook hands with the former Prime Minister. And that shaking of hands became a precursor to the March 9th Harambee House handshake last year. And we, as a Cathedral, are keen to take our position in shaping not just the spiritual life of the nation, but also the socio-political life of our country. And now from the readings that we have heard today, from Matthew chapter 5 and from Ephesians chapter 5, there is one dominant theme, and that theme is light. And I've therefore chosen to title our sharing this afternoon, Shining the Light of Jesus. Because that is what Bob did. As I read his very, very celebrated feature on the newspaper on Tuesday, and as tributes came streaming in up until this afternoon, what we've had here, one thing that defines Bob Colimo is that he's a man who shone light in a world where there was darkness. And so, as we reflect on these two passages, it is important for us to understand what is this call and invitation that God is making on us to shine the light of Jesus. Light in itself enables us to see. Whereas we are all aware that the sun is a source of our natural light, and that the sun produces what in physics we call visible light, and that visible light helps us to see in situations that are clouded by darkness. But whereas on the other side, darkness provides a cover where those who do wrong want to hide, light exposes things as they are. And that is what Paul says when he writes in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 13, that when things are subjected to light, they get exposed. A light, further, reveals things as they are. Once it exposes them, it presents the nakedness of things as they are. And therefore, light defines the truth and distinguishes truth from falsehood. But light also reveals our character. It basically exposes who we are as a people. And that is why, as we celebrate Bob here today, we are able to distinguish a man who shone light of difference in every sphere that he had an opportunity to influence. As we reflect on light, it is important for us to remember that Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God and the Savior of the world, is the source of all light. He says in John chapter 8, verse 12, that I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness. But he also says to his disciples in Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, that we read, that you are the light of the world. So let your light so shine before men that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. In these two verses, Jesus is challenging his disciples to stand out as true representatives in the world around them. What Jesus is doing, he is confirming that he is the source of all light. And as the source of all light, he invites us as humanity to be connected to him so that as a consequence of our connection to him, we may radiate the light that he himself produces. You know, again, in physics, that the moon radiates light that comes from the sun, and through its surface, it reflects the rays that come from the sun. But that radiation and the amount of light you're able to see from the moon is squarely dependent on the positioning of the moon at every particular time as it revolves around. Thus, we too are invited as humanity to be connected to Jesus Christ and to position ourselves correctly so that Christ may hit us with his light, which is the source of every light, so that we may be crumble to make the darkness be the theme. Every occasion where people are. Paul, writing to the church in Ephesus in chapter 5, verse 14, says, "Wake up from your sleep, climb out of your coffins, and that is, arise from the dead, and Christ will show you the light." What Paul is telling us, as he told his disciples then, and the church in Ephesus, is that when we position ourselves in Christ and accept Christ to hit his light on us, that that light begins to redefine our character, and that light seeks to make us a people who will be true representatives of Jesus. Mr. President and fellow mourners here today, as we celebrate Bob Colimo, this is a man that we remember, a man who radiated the light that shone in the forgotten corners of our country, a man who made telecommunications as easy as people who were born in the recent years think that it has been easy like that. This is a man who set himself as an agent of change, a man who influenced both government policy and how the corporate world would do business, a man that we celebrate here today is not a cheap man. But it is important to understand that that sense of being a different man that we are celebrating in him here today is as a result of a character that has been transformed by Jesus Christ. And therefore, Jesus Christ is the agent of transformation. And when he transforms a people, there is only one option for such a people: to shine the light of Jesus Christ. And therefore, as a country and in our positioning at where we are at, it is important to appreciate that we desire change in our country. It is important to appreciate that we desire transformation in this nation. But I'm afraid to say this, that change in this country and across our beloved continent will not come from the many quarters that we think they will come from. And for Kenya in particular, change in our country and the way we do things from governance to all other levels will not come from a referendum that will change the constitution to give a few people positions of leadership. Change will not come from a collision of bigger tribes that coalesce together to form government of national unity, thus pushing to the side smaller communities who are left to scramble for leftovers. Change in this nation will not come merely as a result of the handshake, whereas we appreciate the handshake and the things we have seen come as a result of the handshake. I would love to quote what a good friend and lay reader in this cathedral, Professor P.L.O. Lumumba, says. He says that if you merely take monkeys from one forest and put them in another forest, the monkeys will not change. The monkeys will remain the monkeys. And therefore, from PLO's quote, a lasting change and transformation in this country will come when individuals begin to be changed and transformed from their individual hearts one after another. When members of parliament and politicians at other levels recognize the place of Jesus Christ in changing hearts, in changing character, in shaping our values. A lasting transformation in our country will take place when we appreciate the place of the church, when we appreciate the place of religion in our country. That religion occupies a significant space that would help transform individuals. When we do so, then our jails will have fewer criminals therein, then our parliaments will have responsible politicians whose primary concern will be the welfare of Kenyans. As we celebrate Bob here today, one thing cannot escape your attention as a theme that is repeated one after another, that this was a selfless man who sold himself out to serve humanity and to ensure that every single person under his influence and where he could reach was transformed. And I want to invite all of us as a country, those here at this great cathedral and those who are watching us on the screens, to remember that we each have an opportunity to shine the light of Jesus Christ as Bob did in the different quarters where we are at. When you do that, then we will need less allocation of money for anti-corruption commission, because we will have less people being investigated by NIS or by CID, and we will make the work of the corruption agency very easy, because individuals will be committed to transparency, to integrity, and will carry on the values of honesty that our brother Bob did stand for. When we do so, then our 3 trillion Kenyan shillings budget that was passed just a while ago will be utilized correctly, and we will not have individuals who position themselves to use that money to feed their selfish interests, but we will have people who will ensure that money is channeled to transform and to make a difference in this nation. We will cease, Mr. President, to see politicians driving big vehicles, driving on the wrong side because there's traffic, but rather we will begin to see politicians legislating in the August House and ensuring that Nairobi and other cities are rid of traffic so that all of us have equal access to excellent and quality services in this country. That will happen, and only when character is transformed. And as we celebrate this great man today, I remember reading one of the quotes from one of the newspapers. He said, and I quote, "My purpose is to help as many people as I do the right thing." And he says, "How can I sway people or the government to do the right thing?" Bob did many things that sadly most Kenyans only got to hear when he died. I remember on Tuesday reading religiously the feature that was done by a Nation newspaper, almost word for word, of the life of Bob Collymore. It is so unfortunate that our cultures are very good at celebrating people when they are dead, and we do less of that when people are alive. And unfortunately, the Fourth Estate specializes in selling bad news, and they have succeeded in shaping the psychology of our people and our nations that bad news sells. As a citizen of this nation and as a priest, I look forward to a time when we will never promote darkness over light, a time when we will get to hear stories about good people who serve this nation selflessly when they are still alive. I look forward to reading features of outstanding statesmen and women like the Central Bank Governor Dr. Patrick Lumumba, Chief Justice David Maraga, Professor Margaret Kobia, Bomet Governor Dr. Joyce Laboso, Manu Chandarian, and many of our men and women in uniform and people who make a difference and a contribution for the growth of this country that we never get to hear. I look forward to seeing young people learning positive lessons like we learned here today from our brother Bob. In a dark world, please let us share stories that are positive, stories that are filled with the light of Christ in every space where we are in, because light reveals truth and the beauty that lies in everything. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 to verse 16, Paul says, "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil." To all of us gathered in this historic cathedral, and to all of you Kenyans and members of the international community following us on different platforms, we know not when our Master will come to call us home. Many of us will be called when we are still youthful. Some of us will be called in our middle age, like I am. Others will be called when we are in our old age. Others will go this evening. Some will go tomorrow. Others next year. And we do not know when we will be called. And the great care, therefore, as Paul says, is that we must live our lives carefully this side of eternity and ask, are we in tandem with the Lord Jesus Christ? And are we shining the light of Christ? That have we allowed the light of Christ to transform us, to change us, and to make us a people that God wants us to be? Unfortunately, sometimes our struggles, our wars, our wealth, our positions of influence, our networks, our poverty, our children, and the things that we love to do this side of eternity tend to distract us from connecting with the Lord of light who invites us to shine his light. He is the Lord of light and the Lord of eternity. The day of reckoning is coming when everyone, and everyone literally, will be confronted with one harsh reality: that how did we live our lives this side? Did the properties that we have, did family, did wealth, did friendships, did dreams, did the clubs that we belonged to hinder us from connecting with the King of Light and the Master of Destiny? John, writing in the island of Patmos in Revelation chapter 20, verse 13, says, "That day the sea, the death, Hades, will give up the dead that were in them." And he continues to say, "Then the law and the lost will stand before God in judgment." It simply means that there will be no place to escape. And therefore, as we remember people in death like we do here today, it is incumbent on each one of us to remember our positioning in eternity. Paul reminds us to be careful how we live here today. Not as unwise, but as wise. That every moment we get to hear the gospel of Christ, that every moment you connect to a space where the good news of our Lord Jesus Christ is preached, that you are given an opportunity to secure your destiny with the Creator and to define your legacy when you are still alive. Our brother Bob did define his legacy when he was still alive. He never feared death. He roared at death and looked at death right in the face and told death, "Come, baby, come." Because he was prepared. Rarely do you hear in our African cultures people preparing and beginning a countdown, that I'm left with a month, that I'm left with 3 weeks, that I'm left with 2 weeks. Now it's just a few days, that tomorrow I'll be no more. Rarely do we see that. Beloved, Bob's funeral today, as I conclude, is an invitation for us to remember what Job says in chapter 1, verse 21, that naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will return. And in Mark chapter 8, verse 36, Jesus says, "What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and lost his soul?" The greatest challenge placed before each one of us here today, both the small and the big, the insignificant and the significant, both people who come to church and who don't come to church, is to live every single day of our lives in light of eternity, to give space to the God who is the creator, so that we do not only get to be brought to church when we die, but the church becomes a place that we connect with weekly, so that when death comes, once we make peace with God, we will stare at death and smile and say, I am ready to go home. As Reuben Kigame shared his tribute about Bob Colimo, you will ask, when it's asked who is next, you will be willing to say, here I am, to proceed on. That only happens when you make peace with God, who is the King of eternity. You will then write your will so comfortably and bid your friends goodbye without a rush, over a 3 o'clock tea in on a Saturday, without panic, without shaking your hands, without regrets about your manners, because you will have secured your place in eternity. May the Lord Jesus Christ be the best option for us. As Safaricom is the better option, may the Lord Jesus Christ be the best option, both the side of eternity and the other side of eternity. And I share this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Your Excellency, you can see I hired a good deputy. And that's why I can delegate the pulpit and I will not be ashamed. I guess you would say the same with your deputy. You have a good one as well. We want to bring this service now to a close. Yesterday, as I was seated together with Wamboi talking, we were discussing about this program. And I told her, Wamboi, tomorrow, in the service, I've seen you've put an offering. Where would you like us to dedicate this offering to? And she asked me, Provost, advise me. And I said, when the cathedral turned 100 years, and Your Excellency, you were here, we said, in the next 100 years, our biggest investment in this cathedral will be about children. And not just the 2,000 children who come to the cathedral every Sunday. It's about the children in the streets. It's about the children who are poor in our slums. It's about the children of Kenya. It's about the children in Africa. And so our vision is bigger and greater. And so I want to ask for your indulgence just for 2 minutes. Just watch the cathedral vision so that as you give your offering, you give it to a purpose. What you're seeing there is a building that is now on the fourth floor of just on your left of the cathedral. We started this about 1 year ago. And we want this center to be a spiritual center where children, whether of this church or whichever church, can come and their lives are transformed. We received this cathedral as a gift from the British government. And we have asked ourselves the question, what gift shall we give to our children? And so we want to bequeath this center to the children of the cathedral, the children of Nairobi, the children of Kenya, and the children of Africa. And we have started doing many, many programs that will reach out to every child within and without. We've done the basement, we've done the first floor, we've done the second floor, we have done the third floor. We are now casting the fourth floor of that building. And I'm asking you to stand with us as we cast this vision forward. And in the words of Wamboi, this would be what Bob would have loved because he loved children. And so as you sit at the comfort of your chair, we will have time to give our offerings. And I'll be asking the Safaricom choir to sing as the video comes to an end and as the ushers come to you. Thank you for your support. Thank you very much for your generosity towards the Children's Center of the Cathedral. There are people asking on M-Pesa, you can do pay bill 30-30-35 for the corporates who would like to support us on this journey in transforming children of Africa. We can talk about this later. For now, let us pray for the offerings. Almighty God, you are the source of every blessing, and we thank you that it is you who gives us the ability to make wealth and use the resources that you have given us to transform people's lives. And we thank you that that's what Bob stood for. We pray that these offerings will honor and glorify you, and the givers will be blessed, because you are not a debtor to anyone. You know how to repay. We ask of your blessings upon us and our offerings in the name of God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Allow me now to welcome Canon Joe Ogutu, who will give a vote of thanks. Then we'll pray for the family and the benediction.
Bob arrived in this country in September of 2010, and in the early hours of Monday, he left quietly and peacefully. Yet he did to a thunderous and rapturous standing ovation, the kind of which we have not seen in this country. Robert William Collymore, the ever youthful Mzee, and a gentleman, touched many lives. Since this happened, we've been overwhelmed by the outpouring of love from every part of this country and beyond for this true hero, yet a very simple man. So Wambui has asked me to move this vote of thanks. And so on her behalf, and on behalf of the larger family that Bob belonged to, want to say first and foremost, we thank God, our Creator, who allowed Bob to serve in the way that it did, in a very selfless manner and exemplary way. So we thank you, God, for the life of Bob Collymore. Secondly, Wambui has asked me to express her deepest gratitude to the medical team that attended to Bob with such care and with such dedication. Specifically, she has mentioned Nairobi Hospital, Aga Khan University Hospital, the London Bridge Hospital, Guy's Hospital, the University College London Hospitals. Doctors that attended to him, Dr. Silverstein, Dr. Sandy Patel, Dr. Anne Mwirigi of the Aga Khan University Hospital, who actually attended to Bob to the very last minute. Donald, Panu, Emily, Kelly, Elena, Eve, and probably many others whose names I've not mentioned, your dedicated service and your love and care for Bob throughout this period of Bob's illness will remain etched deeply in the hearts of the family. Thirdly, there are a number of people, support groups, who served as a critical support group to Bob and Wambui during the time of illness. The Boys Club that has already been introduced. A group that is called the Collymore Family Pillar, consisting of Professor Mai, Wambui's mom, Emily, Jessica, Kavutha, Tabby, and Marian. The team at home and around Bob, Agnes, Judy, Isaac, Steve, Ken, George, Dennis, and the entire security team. The young men who gave platelets at that critical time when Bob's body required more. Els and Kamande from Lango Farm. The list surely may not be exhaustive, but please do accept Wamboi's greatest gratitude for your sacrificial giving of your time and resources in support of the family. Fourthly, to the Vodafone and Safaricom family, your support has been absolutely amazing. First, because you provided the platform and the environment for Bob to serve and pursue his vision of touching lives and transforming lives. But it was in the period of his illness that Bob came to really appreciate the support of friends and family, and particularly his colleagues in Vodafone and Safaricom. It was not just because the employer made it possible for him to access the best medical care that modern science could allow, but it was because you were there, you visited him, you spent time with him, you sent messages of encouragement that kept him going and gave the family hope. Please accept Wamboi's and the family's deepest gratitude. And Nick, since you are here, please pass on this message to Vittorio Colao, your predecessor. Bob deeply appreciated the time they spent together. Fifthly, the media. And it's so often that we bash the media, but Bob had a very special connection with the Kenyan media. And so today, Wamboi would want to express her gratitude that you've been able to respect her privacy, particularly during this difficult time. Finally, to you all. You found the time to be here. There are many in the grounds of the cathedral. There are some at Uhuru Park. And there are some who are following this on national TV. We want to thank you for just taking the time to be here and to condole with the family. Last but not least, we want to thank the organizing committee that has spent so much time to put this together. Thank you to the cathedral for allowing us to have this service at a very short notice, and for the facilities that you've put at our disposal to be able to celebrate the life of this great man. And now I invite you to turn to the screens and to see what you're projecting there. I thank you and God bless you.
then again, too few to mention, I did what I had to do and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the highway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who kneels. The record shows I took the blows, I did it
What a wonderful way to end a good service. And what a good way to send a hero. You know, today I have thought about my own death. And I've said, this is the kind of funeral I want. But I will not be there. Let me do something now before I leave, isn't it? Thank you. Let me ask Wamboi and those who are supporting you to come to the center here. Your mom, the mother to Bob and the sister. Sorry, I'll not call many, just the immediate family members to come so that we can pray for you. If you can hold hands together at the middle. Yeah, Jessica, you're supporting Wamboi. If you can hold hands there. We can certainly tell you without prayer it will be very difficult. One boy, Bob's mom and Bob's sister, it will be very difficult without prayer. And as we agreed yesterday, we will continue to visit with you and pray with you and to offer you all the support that you need. Let's now observe a moment of silence. And thank God in our hearts as we remember the life of our departed brother Bob, what he meant for us, and thank God that we had an opportunity to know him. Receive our thanks, Lord, and grant that we shall treasure the memories of our loved ones with sadness and joy, that we were blessed to know them and to know Bob and to share in his life. Grant that we who are still alive shall constantly be reminded that life is fleetingly short. Help us therefore daily to walk in your footsteps, making the best use of our varied talents and living each day as if it was our last. Lord, we thank you for Bob. We were blessed that we are very sad that he had to suffer so much from the illness that afflicted his body. We agonized as we helplessly watched him fight for his dear life. But we are thankful that he does not have to suffer anymore, because he is finally released from the pains and the suffering of this life, and he is united with you in heaven. While we prayed and wished for his physical recovery, we knew that you had the most perfect plan for him, and we have no doubt and know that you have healed him completely, never to suffer these earthly pains or live in constant fear of death. Death is conquered indeed. So we thank you for all who cared for him. Bless the efforts of the doctors who worked so hard looking for new knowledge to cure the disease and to prolong his life. Grant this knowledge, Lord, and bless your people with the gift of long life. Help us to be responsible of our own lives and guard against the dangerous behavior that can harshly cut short our lives. And now to you, members of Bob's family, may the Lord himself be gracious to you and look upon you with favor and grace. May the Lord strengthen you. May the Lord's presence be with you, and especially when you feel lonely and empty. May the Lord surround you with his angels and minister to you during your time of need. And to all the mourners gathered here today and all over the world, may the Lord help us to emulate Bob and to live a life of purpose and die eventually having accomplished the purpose for which we were created. And now the blessing of God the Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and forevermore. Amen. Kindly remain standing there because we are leaving. This is the way we will live. you will lead. We request that we don't interfere with the middle aisle. People can use the northern door, the southern door, and those who are on the sides can use the side doors of the western side. Only those who are in the middle will use the middle aisle to exit. And so once the family leaves, they will go to the west door. They will wait for His Excellency there so that he can condole with you. And once you are there, I will pick His Excellency the President and the other excellencies there and walk with them out, and the rest can follow us as we exit the cathedral. It has been our honor and pleasure to host you at All Saints Cathedral. Please always know you're welcomed to this cathedral. Let us now stand. We'll sing, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah."
Sky, you'll get by. If you smile through your fear and sorrow, smile and maybe tomorrow you'll see the sun come shining through for you. Light up your face with gladness. Hide every trace of sadness. Although a tear may be ever so near, that's the time you must keep on trying. Smile, what's the use of crying? You'll find that life is still worthwhile if you just smile. The time you must keep on trying. Smile, what's the use of crying?
And now the end is near, and so I fence the final. I'm certain I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it than this. I did it.